Okay, really, let me switch to English just to ensure the match with the screen. Okay, so this is the plan, 1, 2, 3, 4, with 1 and 2. One we'll discuss right now, and let me go to the next. Let me just arrange.
Store, she works in Rio de Janeiro.
Okay, so this is 3-4, 3-4. To be quite sure that Galkin is not Serioja, right? VM Galkin, the year was 1973, so definitely not Serioja.
Валь, а можно попросить все-таки зачитывать то, что ты пролистываешь? То, что, ну,
This is just, you know, this is abstract. Yeah, I will. Okay, let me, this is abstract, we will spell everything here, right? But on the other hand, 1, 2 will be some introduction. What we know, it was 4 major, okay. Let me do it exactly what you requested. So 1, 4 major classical theories. There are 28 actually, right? But I will focus exactly on the most relevant one. 4 major, really major classical theories of zeta functions. And the passage to singularities, which is extremely interesting actually. I believe it is the future of this business. Okay, then an introduction to Daha's story, connection with Kovanov-Rosansky polynomials and super polynomials. What are super polynomials? Super polynomials are more or less Kovanov-Rosansky polynomials, but not exactly. There are some nuances here. Okay, this is 1, 2, but we will do it reasonably quickly. Then the main section will be 3, the exact definition of motivic super polynomials or Planck curve singularities. Exact definition, all right, and conjectures. The main conjecture is that they coincide with Galkin's store L functions. Actually, Galkin's, 1973. But Storr wrote a very good paper about this stuff. Okay, and then the end, now we will be flexible, so we can discuss it, right? Will be the story about Riemann hypothesis. I will state, of course, Riemann hypothesis exactly for super polynomials. Somehow it is closer to Selberg's zeta function hypothesis, not exactly to the classical, but we will see anyway. You will see what will happen here. And the point is in yellow, here, right, is that because Daha is very much physical, superconformal field theory, and actually the whole stuff is very much physical, what I will discuss today, then we have some very interesting understanding what can be physics interpretation of the classical grand Riemann hypothesis, even this actually, right? This was totally missing, absolutely missing. So they invented, of course, some kind of what they called Riemann guess, you know, right? But some distribution like logarithms of prime numbers, something like this anyway. But this is artificial, pure mathematical game here. But it seems that we have a real insight now. So what can be the corresponding physics when Riemann hypothesis matters, really matters? Literally, I will try to convince you, literally ensures the existence of the corresponding, or stability, if you wish, of the corresponding physics theory. Okay, so here I will need to say something about Li Yang circle theorem, about Ising models, so it will be no connection with strings or whatever. Okay, so here we are, let me go to, let me proceed with the first item. Which is exactly the picture of the classical, which I promised, of the 4 classical theories, right? Here we are. So slowly. Hasse, Weil, Deligne conjectures for smooth manifolds, right? You define Frobenius, you calculate its eigenvalues, right? In cohomologies or whatever. Finally, you'll get Q, which is Q. Just the cardinality of the finite field here, and T technically is Q to minus S here, right? So two parameters, so functional equation, and of course some statement of some conjecture, and then statement about the absolute values of eigenvalues of the Frobenius operator, Frobenius automorphism here, right? So TQ, right? Absolutely different story. You consider a Riemann surface, consider its uniformization, immediately define the corresponding Laplace operator, right? Calculated zeta function. And then for arithmetic gammas means fundamental group. Anyway, you divide upper half plane by gamma here. So if gamma is arithmetic, the statement is that the smallest Riemann hypothesis, the smallest eigenvalue is greater or equal than whatever, 1/4, something like this. And of course, the definition of zeta, et cetera, et cetera. Zeta is classical. 1/(λi)^2s here. Classical definition. No, absolutely no connection with the first block. Totally, very much analytic story, actually. Then classical stuff, right? And really the most interesting in the whole story here is, of course, Riemann's zeta and Dirichlet L functions here, right? So here, by the way, we're discussing all manifolds of curves, smooth curves here, right? Over fine fields, of course, right? But still, just algebraic geometry classification is quite a problem, et cetera, et cetera. Here we have analytic moduli parameters of discrete subgroups, stuff like this here. Here, definitely, we have very different kind of combinatorics data, to be more exact. This is combinatorics of the Galois group, absolute Galois group, and quasi-characters. Quasi-characters are more than sufficient to make us happy, of course. To prove Riemann hypothesis for directly L functions here. But still, combinatorics, here we have combinatorial data. Here we have algebraic data. Here we have analytic data, right? And here we have a special block when the beginning is very much different from whatever here. You just play with some congruences for Bernoulli numbers here. Eventually, you define Kubota-Leopold zeta function. Generally, you do the same for periodic periods. And so on and so forth here, right? Finally, you'll get, of course, the same, not the same, but some counterpart of the Riemann hypothesis. And surprisingly, it is absolutely no simpler than the Grant conjecture. So here in this business, in spite of a very much combinatorial beginning setting, still there is no simplification. Okay, here it is, right? So four absolutely disconnected blocks here. And we have some absolutely legitimate question. Why we need to do this? For instance, what is the purpose of calculating zeta functions, for instance, here for this particular block here? Of course, when we know the answer, we need to count the number of points over finite fields, right? Zeta function immediately gives you the count of points over finite fields here. Fine, but on the other hand, absolutely different elliptic curves or curves here or manifolds here can have the same, of course, the same count of points, fine points here. So if seriously, if it is some kind of invariant that we don't understand invariant of what? So technically I claim it like this, zeta functions are a very weak invariance of what? Of algebraic varieties of analytic stuff here, et cetera here. So even in the closest possible business, when you consider admissible adelic representations, right? And then you introduce a zeta function, et cetera here. Even in this business, when of course the total number is can be somehow understood here, still zeta function is not an invariant. But here it is as close as possible to the ideal. What can be ideal answer? We calculate zeta functions because they give us whatever, the type of the initial situation, which can be here, but this is as far as possible from what really happens. Here we have literally tons of, anyway, let me say a little something about zeta equivalence. Zeta equivalence is exactly what I'm saying. So what is zeta equivalence of algebraic varieties? So first step is unpleasant. You need to make an algebraic variety, not over C, but over Z. You technically add the corresponding moduli or just coefficients of the equations to your Z here and obtain some finitely generated ring over Z with all the coefficients added, right? And after this, you can define, you consider mod P situation, calculate zeta function, et cetera here. Zeta equivalence means exactly that the corresponding zeta functions coincide. So, and Katz using some stuff before him, he proved that it is a really, really very weak. The best you can do here in this approach to prove that if zeta functions coincide, then the corresponding Hodge numbers coincide. So this is about the best. Of course, no way to capture real moduli, right? But Hodge numbers can be recovered. But this is very much unpleasant because in the beginning you need to add the coefficients of your equations to Z and so on and so forth.
And I'm sorry.
And the no result of the other way around from if the Hodge numbers coincide, does the zeta functions also
coincide? No, only in this direction. So if zeta functions literally coincide, then upon some steps, which are maybe not very much surprising, virtual Hodge number, etc. Upon some steps, you can prove that their Hodge numbers coincide only in this direction. But for elliptic curves, it is total triviality, of course, right?
I am sorry. May I ask, so could you please send the file to the chat so we can, in order to
This is very good idea. So let me do it. So first, let me see what I'm supposed to do. So chat, right? Chat.
Yes, and then there is a possibility.
It was my responsibility. Then how to send a type message here, I see, right?
There is a possibility to attach a file there, so on the right.
On the right, yes, I see dots here, save chat, no, I see, I see file. Okay, perfect, all right, then I will manage. Then my computer, then I know what I'm doing, date modified, I'm in this business, yeah. Again, we're doing introduction later, but later, of course, I believe you, I'm done here.
Yes, thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is page one. Mm-hmm. Page one.
Very good. Thank you.
Okay, clear, right? So anyway, the point, right? Unless you are interested in distribution of prime numbers or in points mod p, right, of some algebraic varieties, there are no serious reasons to study zeta functions unless you are interested in arithmetic or in some special questions about Laplace operators here, right? So here we are, right? But on the other hand, let me show you what happens practically immediately when you switch to singularities. Okay, so this is the second and the end of introduction, actually, the second transparency, the second slide. Okay, so first we have some job to do here. So we need to restate Weiss conjectures for singularities. By singularities, I mean isolated singularities. Just singularities, pure singularities, not singular curve, but just isolated singularities. And the whole business is at the moment is for curves, for plane curve singularities. But generally, of course, you can try to do it for any isolated singularity here, right? So you need to restate, this is not true. Of course, Riemann hypothesis was proven for smooth varieties with some reservations can be not only smooth, but anyway, mostly it is, you need smooth because you need Poincaré duality actually and some other stuff here. So first you need to restate it, right? Absolutely, Riemann hypothesis simply wrong. It is absolutely not granted, but from functional equation, more or less can be expected because Poincaré duality can be somehow said. But anyway, we have pure singularity. Pure singularity means an isolated singularity here, right? So first we need to restate this particular business. What are zeta functions? Zeta functions will of course become Hilbert zeta functions. So we will discuss it in full detail with complete definitions here. Okay, first block. Second block still can be fixed, right? But you need to switch from the classical uniformization by upper half plane to the one which is Schottky uniformization. Schottky uniformization is compatible with the passage to singularities. This is very interesting, but not surprising for those who know Deligne, Mumford and some other works about on periodic Schottky uniformization, right? So it can be restated anyway for singularities, at least this good news here. And then immediately, of course, we understand that this particular Schottky uniformization has a direct counterpart, periodic counterpart here. Schottky uniformization is classical stuff. You consider C complex plane here, remove some points, right? Which will be some limiting points of the corresponding discrete subgroup. Discrete subgroups will be with G generators, not with 2G generators and so on and so forth here, right? So C with some punctures here, right? Instead of upper half plane here. And then there is an immediate, practically immediate periodic anel here and the link. Here, definitely we have here a link to Kubota-Leopold zeta functions and the Vassal polynomials. Already good here, right? Then, of course, the main block unchanged. Same Riemann zeta, same Dirichlet L functions here. But here we have, even in the beginning, we had some problems with combinatorics and with QNT. In this business, definitely we have QNT, right? We discussed it. Here I will, let me skip it completely, right? But anyway, here we have QNT. Here we have only one parameter, no Q, only T. Right, only one parameter here. Classical Riemann zeta, actually it is S, right? But you can recalculate it, right? One parameter here, two parameters here. Here relation is T equals Q to minus S here. This, here we have only one S, no Q here. Okay, so but on the other hand, still by brute force long ago, like 20 years ago, by literally by brute force, I introduced Q zeta, Q Dirichlet functions, et cetera, et cetera, added Q, and found, believe it or not, found some Riemann hypothesis there. It is the end of my paper, which is published and was published in Selecta here, the very last chapter here, exactly Riemann hypothesis, right? With some minor tricks, exactly that zeros of something, of some Q counterparts, Q variants, they belong to the line real part of S equals one half, exactly, right? But on the other hand, still right now it's, it must be revisited, of course. Okay, so here we have some kind of block, right? Q zeta, because just to ensure the connection with grand conjectures here, and the key, which I'm going to discuss, invariance of threefolds here, right? So why, I will explain, but not right now here. Okay, look what we have here. This block exists, Weyl's conjecture, but there are some question marks, definitely. This potentially exists here, right? This is unchanged. And here we have the same Kubota-Leopold zeta, but at least now we have some connection between the left block here, this particular block, and between this block here. Okay, let me just look at T and Q parameters here. So Q zeta story, T equals Q to S, right? So I used, of course, just because of my instincts, use the same kind of relation, T equals Q to S here. For Weyl conjecture, it is T equals Q to minus S, but it's the same, of course. Then this is exactly the point connected with threefolds, right? So Hilbert zeta functions of surface singularities, presumably. So conjecture here is that if you consider Hilbert zeta functions to be defined for curves of surface singularities, of isolated surface singularities, right? Then this particular guys properly defined are exactly, right, kind of strongest version of conjecture are exactly the corresponding Dirichlet L functions here. Okay, this is interesting. So, and there is something, definitely something to discuss. So before this, we had absolutely different data stories here. Here we have this block, the most interesting and the most attractive block is very much combinatorial. Again, Galois and quasi characters here, right? Okay, so what do we have? Here it is the same, right? Here, all other blocks, this is somehow isolated. I will not discuss it today here. But here we have absolutely different kinds of data, right? But on the other hand, if you do singularities, definitely the classification is much, much simpler. But the key point is not only to do singularities, but to do topological types of singularities. Here we are. Now, here in this story, you say Dirichlet quasi character. Here, you almost immediately consider corresponding length spaces, which are more or less one to one with Dirichlet characters here. Anyway, length spaces, Zeifert space, et cetera, et cetera. So, upon these two steps, first step to singularities, the second step to topological types of singularities, you will get combinatorics, which is very much similar to what you can expect in grand conjectures, right? So Dirichlet character means some kind of NM here. Here you have torus nos, or to be more exact, length spaces, corresponding length spaces here. So at least here, and at some very heuristic level, you have connection of the data here. Okay, so here it is the same story, right? And the main conjecture for curves, or presumably, but we're only in the beginning, even for surfaces, means that zeta function now is an invariant, really an ultimate invariant of topological type of singularity. Now it explains everything. So if it is true for this block, for this block, for this block, and for this block, right? With proper words about connections here, right? Then the whole story is just becomes the coincidence of these four theories becomes pretty much by definition, by construction. Because if they are invariants of the same thing, which are exactly invariants of surface, if you want to go to the level of grand conjectures of surface, isolated surface singularities, maybe not all, there are some special corresponding to Zeifert threefolds to be more exact here, right? Then, of course, all these four blocks coincide automatically. The only problem is to get explicit formulas. Okay, here we are, right? So we reduced by these two steps, the passage to singularities and the passage to topological types of singularities, make these four potentially connected. And this is actually the end of introduction with one reservation. Okay, this is the end of introduction, right? Okay, this is just for your convenience to show T and Q parameters. So here it is T and Q by hands here. For Hilbert Z, it is classical, we do algebraic varieties, actually singularities, but still t is q to minus x here. Here qt, the Daha story. Qt are just because of absolutely different reasons, actually from physics, right? Q and t are just the Daha parameters here. Here, let me skip completely what happens with the spectral story of Laplace operator under Schottky uniformization. Okay, essentially we're done, but I need to explain to make it a little bit more precise. So how to make zeta functions topological invariants, right? So what are the steps here? Because these steps are non-trivial. So step number one, right? So again, you remember there was an unpleasant part of the story when you have a complex algebraic variety, you technically made it a scheme over Z, right? Here no need to do some artificial steps like this. You prove some kind of lemma, right? Lemma is that if you consider hypersurface singularities and only its topological type, it can be defined over Z. So no need to consider arbitrary algebraic varieties with arbitrary coefficients. Coefficients can be assumed over Z, actually. So is it true or not? I don't know, but for curves, definitely it is true. Or everything is true, what I'm saying, right? But then the next step is pretty much standard. You consider points of good reduction, which meaning that it remains, it is not good reduction means if it was smooth, it remains smooth. Here the definitions are somewhat different, of course, you understand, right? But still there is a notion of point of good reduction. And for curves, the claim is that all prime numbers, all Qs, all prime numbers are points of good reduction. So here with the first, it is pretty much what you can expect. The second is more involved. The second is that then, of course, you have singularity. Of course, Jacobian or whatever is not well defined, but you can define readily compactified Jacobian to be defined today for curves here. So compactified Jacobian, you introduce compactified Jacobian or band GX generally or whatever you like here, right? But you need to do something. You need to prove that this particular scheme is of strong polynomial count. The definition, you count points over FQ, and this is depends polynomially on Q. Of course, it is totally wrong for elliptic curves in finite over finite fields here, right? So because there are some transcendental terms here, definitely. But in the business of singularities, this is very much expected that you, if you consider corresponding compactified Jacobian and count points, this particular formula will depends on Q uniformly. Okay, so the second level. And then after this, of course, you can claim now, you can state conjecture that the corresponding zeta function, Qt, and then you consider inflected one to have a strong invariant here. This is a topological invariant, presumably Qta, and you'll get your initial topological type of singularity.
Vanya, I'm sorry, what are these parameters, Qt and A?
Qt, Q, the cardinality of finite field here, right?
Okay.
Q.
Okay.
T is Q to minus S, right? We don't change anything. So T, like in algebraic geometry, in generally vague conjectures here, T is Q to minus S here, right?
And what is A?
What is A? To be discussed next, flagged zeta function, just to have a stronger invariant, right? This is Toos Havanov-Razansky, so you need letter A here, right?
Will you give a definition of this?
Zen, it is very simple. Instead of counting points, here, of course, we are doing ideals, not points, because everything is singular. We'll discuss it. I will give you the definition, right? You consider flex of ideals, simple, right? And A is the length of the flag.
But you will give the definition, right?
Oh, yeah, okay. Absolutely, okay. Absolutely. And now I'm really done. So it is the end of the story, the end of introduction here. Now we can do
some. You look for Hilbert scheme, you have Hilbert scheme of A points.
But later, guys, later. So now it is pretty much the beginning of my talk here. I already invested, spent, wasted 30 minutes, we're relaxed today, I believe. Okay, so what is the simplest definition of double fine Hecke algebra, right? The shortest, not the simplest maybe, but the shortest, definitely topological one. You do the following. You consider two-dimensional torus, a topological torus, just C2 divided by any lattice here, topological torus. Then you consider what we call elliptic configuration space, E to N minus the diagonal, right? Diagonals to be more exact, right? Minus the diagonal cross, right? Divide by Sn because the action is now unramified here, right? And calculate pi one. This is called B elliptic, right? Elliptic braid group here. Okay, so what is Daha? Daha is the group algebra of this particular guy, literally like what we routinely do in the story about character varieties, right? But now it is a special thing, elliptic configuration space here. So then you'll take fundamental group, right? It's the corresponding group algebra and divide by quadratic relations. The only thing which I cannot motivate right away here is that it must be uniform for all TIs here. TIs are, of course, half turns here, and I always assume that there's A and B. The same for all I's here. Potentially, you can play with this, you can make them different, but let's do it exactly this way. Let's assume one quadratic relation for all half turns here. Half turns because of the classical definition of the break group. TIs are local from one to N here. Okay, clear, right? So very simple definition. And then immediately because of this definition, let me skip this part about non-commutative Kadaira Spencer, et cetera, et cetera. Let me just skip it completely. But what it follows immediately from this definition is that there is an action of PSL to Z, projective PSL to Z. What is projective PSL to Z? PSL to Z is generated by S and T, two matrices, classical matrices here, right? But due to Steinberg, the corresponding projective canonical central extension is just B3, braid group three with three braids here, right? So with two generators, T1, T2 here. And classical relation T1, T2, T1 equals T2, T1, T2 here. That's it. This is projective PSL to Z. Okay, so the claim just because of the definition immediately, right? Again, it is, but anyway, because of the definition, you meet obtain that B3 projective PSL to Z acts by outer automorphisms on Daha, on double fine Hecke algebra, right? Here, of course, it is important, but anyway, this is exactly the claim. So you define, remember the story about unramified case when you just consider elliptic curve. So fundamental group of elliptic curve is just Z squared. And of course, PSL to Z acts there, right? Because Z times Z here, right? So this absolutely the same, but now you consider elliptic curve with a puncture, if it is one elliptic curve, but we consider now E to N here. Okay, so instead of elliptic curve and pi one, we consider elliptic curve with one puncture and pi one. And then of course it is very much predictable that the corresponding Techmuller group PSL to Z will act there, but not exactly a PSL to Z, only its projective central extension, projective PSL to Z, which is canonical central extension of PSL to Z. Okay, perfect, right? So this is the simplest one, but there are two more classical definitions of double fine Hecke algebra from absolutely different sources. So first definition is essentially equivariant T times C star ring actually, right? Anyway, in equivariant K theory here of affine flag varieties of the of this affine flag variety G divided by B hat. Hat means affine here, right? To be more exact, this is polynomial representation. If you want to make it exact, you need to do the following. You need to consider the square of affine flag variety, affine Grassmannian, let me just say affine Grassmannian here, right? Affine Grassmannian times affine Grassmannian here. Then there is canonical Lagrange subvariety, and then you consider K, equivariant K theory with respect to T torus multiplied by C star, which is responsible for Q, by the way, right? And you will get exactly the double affine Hecke algebra. Actually, it was my way was actually this way, not exactly topological. With topology, I somehow observed it later here. So what I did, I considered Lustig's classical theory without hats, then Lustig operators, operations or de Maizière Lustig operators, T1, T2, Tn minus one, which immediately for, in cohomology, they are Bernstein, Gelfand, Gelfand, but here they are just some kind of T1, T2 operators or operations, if you wish. And I added T0. Adding T0 means the passage to affine flags. So this is exactly what I did, and then some technical story here. Then very quickly, I understood that if I want to understand the action of PSL to Z, this is absolutely unsatisfactory approach. It's very difficult to see the action of PSL to Z in this approach. And then I found that it is much more reasonable to use topologic approach, and then the equivalence took some time to establish the equivalence of these two definitions. First myself, for arbitrary systems, not for Gillian, for arbitrary systems here. Anyway, it took some time, but now it is done, of course. Okay, so we have two definitions. The first definition, topological, very nice, one line, almost one line. The second requires, still short, it was Total formalization was by Grainovsky, Jan Grainovsky and Garland here, and Ginsburg, Vissero, Kapran, Kapran, Ginsburg, Vissero here. So this is really Grainovsky paper is like whatever, 5 pages maybe, right? Something like Grainovsky, Garland. So not too difficult. You need to spell what are these guys are, right? Theorems are pretty much by definition here. Okay, so this is the second definition, but I'm pretty much sure that many of you, some of you used it, right? Almost all of you know that it is K theory of affine flake varieties, right? Daha connected. Yes, of course, it's connected because of this definition here. But there is one more definition of the same conceptual level here, the definition of isometric spaces. This is a very interesting story. Old story, so Katz-Moody story, Katz-Moody theory resembles very much the classification and the theory of symmetric spaces, but this is absolutely not the same here. Let me show you why. For instance, in the story about symmetric spaces, there is some type C check C. MacDonald called grandfather, right? Which has 5 T's and 1 Q. There is way, way above any Katz-Moody constructions. We consider, of course, some kind of algebras like, some different families of algebras here, but definitely there is absolutely impossible to have 5 T's and 1 Q here, right? So this is the story. So symmetric spaces accidentally very much similar to classification of affine Lie algebras here, right? But only accidentally. Generally, we have two different stories with two different backgrounds. And then there is a story about Laplace operator, about its simplification via Dunkel operator, and so on and so forth here. Eventually, you'll get double affine definition of double affine Gibbs algebra. So three major sources for arbitrary root systems. For type A, there are many more actually, right? So Schiffman Vissero. Kapranov, maybe Schiffman, Vissero, Kapranov, right? Zeta function was used here, right? Then shuffle algebras, right? Then quantum groups connected with shuffle algebra. Then duality with toroidal algebras. And actually more of this. Again, let me mention here that this is a story about Daha. For MacDonald polynomials, sometimes they appear without any Daha. They appear as some kind of standard generating functions in some theories of homology or cohomology theories here. So, but there is something else. Not always there is a double fine Gick algebra. If you have MacDonald polynomials, not always, right? But still we have three canonical definitions and a lot of stuff in type A here. Okay, this is a definition, right? But I promise that everything will be defined. Here it is, right? A1 case. What is Daha, double fine Gick algebra, right? For A1, root system is A1 here. Very, very simple, right? But on the other hand, still, it is a good portion, like one half of my book about just classification of just some story about definition, this formal definition, which is one line, of course, right? And then classification of representations, including group of unity. Okay, so, but then definition, T, X, Y, right? What is T? Half a turn, of course, right? X, Y means exactly moving X, right? So here we have the picture, right? So this is Y, right? And this is X, right? Here we have some kind of star point here, right? Here we have zero, right? And T is exactly like this, right? And then if you look at this particular picture, you immediately get the relation Y minus one X minus one Y X T squared equals one, topological relation. Right, equals one, so Q appears here because of some rescaling, which I'm not going to discuss. So you remember quadratic relations contain two parameters. Here I rescale them to make this relation one. But anyway, let me prove it. So T squared first, right? T squared, right? Then Y, then X, then Y minus one, X minus one. You avoid the puncture, perfect, right? So this is puncture. So a y minus one x minus one y x t squared equals one, right? Then upon renormalization, I impose some standard quadratic relation for t, but on the other hand, the price of this is that I will get here q, just because it is non-homogeneous. Clear, right? So literally topological definition, literally, right? And of course, the action of PSL2Z is granted. What are the formulas? Tau plus, which stays for the classical metrics, right? So one, zero here, right? Classical matrix, right? Y will go to XY basically, right? X will stay put, T goes to T here. And this parameter is just because of rescaling here. Okay, and tau minus, right? Tau minus, same, but now for X's. X will change to YX with some scaling coefficient here. And of course, y will stay put, t will stay put here. What is sigma Fourier transform? Minus 1, 1. Minus 1, 1, 0, 0 here, right? Sigma Fourier transform, right? Here it is the formula. Tau plus, tau minus, minus 1, tau plus here. Okay, perfect. And of course, the claim is that tau plus, tau minus satisfy Braid relation. What is Braid relation? Tau plus, tau minus, minus 1, tau plus equals exactly the opposite. Tau minus, tau plus, minus 1, tau minus. Just one Braid relation. You remember S1, S2, S1 equals S2, S1, S2. So only this relation is imposed. This is definition due to Stabenk of exactly of PSL2Z, projective PSL2Z here. Okay. No need to check anything because it is automatically follows from topological definition. The existence of tau plus, tau minus, and of course the relation. Very interesting, by the way, right? Because checking directly is doable, right? And you will have fun, but you will not understand how simple it is really. Topologically, it is very simple. Okay, perfect. Now, the second level, right? This is topological one. It is about the best you can do topologically. But if you need polynomial representation, you need really K theoretic definition. So this definition, again, is a sort of trivial, but only if you use K theoretic definition. So T will go to Lustig's operation to divide the difference, Lustig de Maizière operation. Lascouche, Berger, de Maizière, Lustig to be more exact here, right? Clearly divided difference, right? We understand the origin, K theory, of course, from K theory, right? T, then X will go to X. So it X in polynomial representation. Laurent polynomials, X plus minus one here, right? So again, this is topological part of the story. This is now a K theoretic part of the story when it is pretty much automatic because of definitions. Right, divide difference definitely are because of definitions. So X will go to X, right? X will become X here. And Y, the formula for Y, you can introduce T naught, but I will not do it. Instead, I will just give you an explicit formula for Y. S, P, T. T is here, right? S is reflection, P is translation by one half. Okay, here we are. Theorem, right? This particular guy has a very small, very nice, and very small representation in polynomials. Normally, of course, the classical representation is in the group algebra itself, but this is much, much smaller. Okay, so claim is that we have the action of double Weingeck algebra, right, in polynomials. So this is literally a generalization, a deformation, to be more exact, of the classical stuff about Heisenberg. Heisenberg and Weyl algebras, which always have some canonical representation in polynomials, in standard polynomials or Laurent polynomials. This is absolutely a deformation, QT deformation of the story about polynomial representation of the Heisenberg algebra here, which is so much fundamental for all of us. Okay, perfect, right? So then explicit formulas, very nice. Now we have quite a challenge to calculate explicit formulas, right? For tau plus, for what? For tau plus and tau minus here. So here we have the, I gave you the formula for GLN now, right? Definition was for A1, but the formula is pretty much uniform for any GLN here. So here we have, of course, X1, X2, et cetera, Y1, et cetera here, right? So the formulas are pretty much the same, but you need to put one four times here, 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 and here. Same word for tau minus, right? For Y, there is minor difference. So here Y was SPT here. Now it will be pi and the product of all braids in this particular order here. Okay, you see, it is really simple. The passage to GLN or to N braids here is absolutely not a problem. Okay, so here we are, right? More or less what I want to say. And now immediately, let me go immediately to invariants, to super polynomials, and then it will be just one more step and I will state Riemann hypothesis for super polynomials. Okay, so to begin with, it was historically, it was like this. Let's begin with torus knots, right? So torus knots, T, R, S here. There are a couple of definitions. So here it is in terms of lines here, horizontal and vertical, but from algebra, from viewpoint of singularity theory, it will be like this. You consider equation X to R equals Y to S at zero, right? Intersected with small three-dimensional sphere, right? We're discussing C squared, right? C squared. This is the same here, right? And see what you can see, and you will get it, your smooth torus. This is Arnold's vision, actually, right? Arnold criticized algebraic geometry, but which algebraic geometry? Projective first, because he mentioned that projective is just for the sake of simplicity to ensure that you have that functions, global functions are just constants here, right? So projective algebraic geometry. And more seriously, he criticized smooth, but smooth was, for all of us, smooth was just technical necessity here. So in the very beginning of algebraic geometry, of course, it was about everything, about smooth and non-smooth here. But on the other hand, to simplify our life, we switched to, for 100 years, to smooth manifolds here, right? And somehow postponed with projective algebraic geometry almost immediately appeared. There is no question about it.
Your singularity is isolated.
Isolated, yeah.
Yeah, but then smooth projective is just subclass of isolated, if you take the call.
Smooth projective.
Yeah, smooth projective variety. You take the code, and then you have isolated singularity. So.
Yes. But what is the statement or question?
I mean, I don't see why one criticizes it. Just standard.
Arnold, first of all, we cannot ask Vladimir Evgenievich, right? I'm really very very sorry about this, but this is life, you know, right?
Vladimir Igorevich.
On the other hand, definitely his vision, okay, let me try to recover, right, his vision. But unfortunately, actually, we talked a lot with him, but never discussed mathematics. But anyway, his vision, more or less, it is my attempt, of course, very brave attempt to recover his vision. His vision was that the story must be like this. You have singularities, algebraic singularities are fine. Then you intersect them with some spheres here, right? Like a three-dimensional sphere. And then you'll get smooth, which is very much important. Smooth, three-folds or whatever. Nodes here in this business, right? Generally three-folds, n-folds here. So his vision is that we're surrounded by literally tons of smooth real varieties. But algebraic varieties, smooth algebraic varieties are somewhat because we like them, because we have forms, we have Durham. Because they're smooth, you know, right? This was his vision that if you want to approach real life, you know, right? Then singularities potentially are sufficient. But again, it is my very brave attempt to recover, which cannot be recovered actually, right?
It's Sasaki Einstein, usually they say.
Yeah, but please say it again. Please say it again. I just didn't hear.
Sasaki-Einstein
geometry. Can we discuss it after the talk? It's very interesting to me. Can we discuss it after the talk here? Can we? Guys?
Yes, can the answer is yes.
Yeah, the answer is yes. Okay. Just to not to lose focus here, right? It was my mistake, of course, to try to touch such issues here. And really, I'm not quite prepared. We'll discuss it after the talk here. Perfect. But anyway, torus node, right? No question about this, right? Two definitions, topological definition, classical definition, when you begin with the torus, and algebraic definition, right? Perfect. Well done. So what, then technical thing. Let's represent torus nodes as SL2Z matrices, right? To prepare the formula below here, right? But on the other hand, we have only R and S, and here we have star and star, whatever. Nothing is supposed to depend on this particular column here in the construction below here. Anyway, RS, and here you have arbitrary X and Y such that determinant is one.
Integral. So, Vanya, this gamma is one matrix or many matrices?
Take any. Take any. The simpler, the better, but take any, right? And the first test of the theory was that nothing depends on this particular column, which is star-star column.
Very good.
The first lemma, right? It required some proof, proving, but this is a very simple one. There's some more interesting stories about topological invariance of the construction. Okay, so what is the construction? Slowly now, right? So Daha, double fine Geeky algebra, take A1, fine. So take arbitrary double fine Geeky algebra with two parameters Q and T. Remember, Q is because of renormalization, T is because of quadratic relation. For whatever root system. But if you have BC, you have two T's and so on and so forth here, right? Let's assume that we have just one T here. And AN, the whole story will be actually about AN mostly. So HQT here, right? Daha, right? Any root system, but AN is just fine. And AN is anyway, will appear at level 6, only AN will survive. Then arbitrary dominant weight. right? Perfect. This will be color. Then MacDonald polynomial, right? P lambda eigenfunction of the corresponding symmetric operators, et cetera, here, right? You consider polynomial representation, you consider only symmetric part of this representation, then you symmetrize Y operators, you will get MacDonald operators, and then anyway, diagonalize them, you'll get pi lambda of X here. Of course, the formulas are well known for A1, but for A2, they are quite involved already. Okay, perfect, right? So the construction, I need just one more piece from general theory, the notion of the co-invariant. What is co-invariant, right? Take operator. Operator will be an element or linear combination of elements from, anyway, an element from double fine Gick algebra. A linear combination of X, Y, and T, right? Then you do the following. You treat this element as an operator in the polynomial representation. First, second, apply it to one. You will get a polynomial now, right? And then evaluate. Evaluation is X goes to T to minus rho here. Simple. For A1, I will show you the how it works very explicitly here. So the notion is this is called co-invariant. Projection on symmetrizer, if you wish, anyway, co-invariant, right? And the definition, Dahad-Jones polynomials, right? So do the following, take gamma, right? Gamma is from SL to Z. Lift it to projective SL to Z, meaning that is not non-canonical. So anyway, not unique. Lift it anyway, right? First of all, this is not unique, right? You have two stars here. Then lift it to PSL to Z to the braid group to B3, to the braid group B3 here, right? Then apply it to pi lambda divide, this is normalization matter, pi lambda of T to rho here, right? Evaluation here. What does mean apply? You cannot definitely, PSL to Z does not act in the corresponding Fock representation, polynomial representation is classical, right? Fourier transform changes that changes polynomial representation to another representation. Pretty much classical stuff, Heisenberg X in the polynomial representation, but not PSL to Z definitely. This is the whole story is exactly that Fourier transform does not act in the polynomial representation. It transforms polynomials to delta functions, right? So here, consider this guy as an operator, as an element from Daha, and then you can, as an operator, but as an element of Daha, double fine KK algebra here, and then after this, you can apply this guy here, and then apply co-invariant here. After this, it is well-defined. Okay, this is construction, right? And then the end of the story, super polynomials, right? Do it for AN. And then the claim is that there exists polynomial in terms of QT, depending on lambda, of course, lambda is a color. Color must be stable for AN here, some polynomial, QT and A or in terms of three letters here. When you substitute A is minus T to N plus one, you'll get exactly five, level five here. So the claim is that there exists a polynomial in terms of QT with some positivities, but anyway, some polynomial in terms of QTA here, depending on lambda, which is a colored, conjecturally colored Havanov-Rozanski polynomial for torus node. But colors are very difficult actually for Havanov-Rozanski theories. Mostly it is uncolored, but recently, of course, we have some stuff about colors, but this is quite unpleasant actually. Links and colors are unpleasant in Havanov-Rozanski theory. But anyway, here we have exactly the candidate, right? With arbitrary color lambda, which is an arbitrary dominant weight here. Okay, questions here, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? You see, extremely simple, literally, right? And then, of course, lemma is that nothing depends on this star and star here, right? And nothing depends on the lift to projective PSL to Z, projective SL to Z here, right? And then, of course, the existence, the key lemma is, of course, the existence of the super polynomial QTA, such that upon these specializations, right? N can be 1, 2, 3, whatever here, you will get exactly something obtained at level 5. Level 5 is pure representation theory, level 6 is some kind of stabilization. Okay, let me show you an example, trefoil, right? So for trefoil, we literally need to do the following. Trefoil can be represented by the corresponding product of tau plus and tau minus. just a standard calculation with continued fractions generally, right? Three, two, if you want to make three and two here, right? Then consider the following product of these matrices here, tau minus squared, tau plus, then apply it to X1. I promised MacDonald polynomials, symmetric MacDonald polynomials, but I will explain why you can do it for non-symmetric polynomials, right? Apply it to non-symmetric, this is the non-symmetric polynomial MacDonald polynomial for omega one here, right? Then a very simple calculation, which we will do in a moment here, right? And you will get the formula. One plus AQ plus QT here. The formula.
May I ask one step back? I do not understand the definition of this in the point six. What is A in the left-hand side? H, the ha, TRS, how it depends on the...
Anton, what is missing here? That there exists a polynomial in terms of Q, T, and A such that...
Okay.
Is it easy to prove? Yeah, we have now technical tools which makes it straightforward, right? But definitely it is something which, from the viewpoint of the logic of this approach...
But there is a polynomial that depends on R and S.
What is the
meaning of the symbols H and the high in the top?
Yes, this is literally Deligne program. Deligne program is SLT, right? T is a complex number, mm-hmm. SLT. This is literally A is exactly his T, actually, right? So we found that all GLNs somehow come from GLT. T is some mm-hmm. absolute parameter, right? But upon specialization, you need to go back to A1, A2, A3, etc. here.
Mm-hmm.
This is absolutely towards Deligne's program or whatever, right? Absolutely the same. So stabilization in terms of rank, right? Clear to all of you, right? It is really missing here. I'm sorry. So there exists a polynomial in terms of Q, T, A, such that, right? Such that you will get 5 for when N is 1, 2, 3. Actually, N is 0 is okay. N is 0.
And the polynomial is unique.
Only finitely many of them are sufficient, right? But you have infinitely many values of A here, right?
Yes.
Even finitely many. So here, by the way, you see, and the formula, so upon this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 definition, you will get something totally trivial for A1 here, right? For trefoil here, 1 plus AQ plus QT here, right? So I'm very happy about this 1, 2, 3, 6, but it appeared the super polynomial for trefoil is total triviality algebraically, 1 plus AQ plus QT here. And this is Mativic story. So in Mativic approach, it will be immediate one line calculation on this particular guy here. Okay, any questions? This is the beginning and the end of the story about double fine Geeky algebra. Then we will switch to Mativic. Mativic is necessary because there must be some explicit reasons why it is so simple here. So after Mativic definitions, this will be immediate. This formula, right, will be absolutely immediate. One line. No 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Vanya, I'm sorry, may I ask one clarifying question? So this is the result of some computation or it's obvious?
No. Computations. Uh-huh. This is exactly my point, right? So first of all, AN is necessary here, right? Uh-huh. Fortunately for AN, we have very nice formula for the action of tau minus, tau plus, right? Then the passage from symmetric polynomials to non-symmetric polynomials. This is lemma, but the justification is not too difficult here, right? X1 here, right? Okay, let me show you exactly this calculation. So here it is, right? Exactly Jenny's question here, right? So it is A1 only. Only one, so we have only one x here. Again, the simple lemma is that I can switch to from symmetric polynomials, MacDonald polynomials, to non-symmetric. What is non-symmetric polynomial? E1 equals x, right? Classical formula for minuscular weights, for any minuscular weights here, right? Okay, so here it is, my construction, right? Your question was, is the result of calculation? Yes, it is the result of calculation. Here it is, right? Tau plus tau minus x, right? First of all, you apply tau minus to x. It will be yx up to some const. This means up to some const, some power of q, qt power here, right? Then you apply, you do it twice, right? So
tau should minus we understand of, why there is tau plus and tau minus squared because of numbers 3, 2, how they are related?
Oh yeah, because it is the product. Okay, let me just do it the following. I have a lot of space here, right? So if you consider exactly, very good question, absolutely legitimate, right? So this exactly, I'm just producing the corresponding guy here, 1, 1, 1, 0, squared here, right? I claim that the first column will be 3-2. Obvious, not exactly obvious, but this will be 1-2 here, right? And then 3. 3 is granted here. And the same, there will be 2 here.
Yeah, thank you.
Right?
Right.
Star, it depends on me. Star, there will be some. Of course, you can committee calculate what the star and star here, right? Maybe 1-1 here, right? But anyway, no, star and star here. This is the way, a non-trivial way to encode actually simplest singularity. Trefoil is, of course, the simplest singularity. Okay, clear, right? This is about this one. Okay, let's do it now, right? Tau minus squared, right? X multiplied by y squared, right? Tau minus squared up to proportionality. Tau minus squared applied to x. X is exactly McDonald polynomial here, right? Will be essentially, let me make it like this. X, y squared, agree, right? What is tau minus? Multiplication by y on the left, 2 times, right? Then you apply tau plus. Tau plus means that y will become, the first y will become yx, the second will become yx. Here it is what we need to calculate. Clear, right?
I'm happy.
Tau minus of x, y squared up to some power of q. Applying tau minus means multiplication on the left by y, right? You remember it is the matrix 1, 0, 1, 1, right? Y squared. Good. Yeah, I assume that is okay with all of you. Right? Then you have y squared. Now you need to apply tau plus. Tau plus means that x will be unchanged, but here you will get xy and xy 2 times. Anton,
maybe understandable.
Yes. I'm fine. Yeah.
Okay, guys, and I'm checking connection. So connection is okay so far, right? Then we have, as always, we have some word, right? Long word here. But on the other hand, now everything is applied to one. X to one is x, right? Then next level, y applied to x. Y to x is x because it is a McDonald polynomial, a non-symmetric McDonald polynomial, right? Mm-hmm. So then if you have x on the left, right, then it can be deleted because upon taking the co-invariant, it will be some power of q, right, or power of qt here, can be deleted, right? Finally, we need just to calculate y of x squared, right? This is a non-trivial calculation because x squared is not a McDonald polynomial here, right? But this is very explicit. You will get this particular formula. So here is a perfect answer to Jenny's question. So technical calculation, but on the other hand, quite simple for trefoil, right? Then the whole point, I provided the formulas for GLN. The whole point is that it's absolutely the same for GLN, but you will get different powers of Q here, right? No, not exactly T squared, but different powers of T here, right? So this is exactly the formula. Oh, by the way, Jones polynomial is when T is replaced by Q, then you will get a classical formula for Jones polynomial for trefoil. But we are doing refined polynomials, the Hodgson's polynomials. Okay, and the end of the story, 1 plus AQT here. The claim is that when A is minus T squared, you will get what we calculated. But if A is minus T cube, minus T to 4, et cetera, you will get the Hodgson's for A2, for A3, and so on. But I provided all the stuff here in the notes. You have the file here, right? Which is necessary to calculate it. Okay, then again, Anton's question, if you know the degree of A is one, then this very calculation is sufficient to recover it uniquely, right? Generally, there is a formula, degree A degree of this particular guy here is exactly given by this nice formula. Mostly it is, of course, the number of boxes in the Young diagram here, right?
I'm sorry, what is H lambda RS?
Oh, this is this guy. So lambda is box in uncolored, Box means uncolored, right? Uncolored means minuscular weight. E1 is X here. Uncolored, minuscular weight here. Lambda is arbitrary Young diagram. If Young diagram is one box, it is exactly when it is uncolored case, we call it uncolored, you know, right? When it is fundamental weight here, exactly X. Lambda is arbitrary weight. So we're doing something which is actually beyond Havanov-Rozanski, colored polynomials.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Right, here we have nice formula. You see, just depends on the number of boxes directly here, right? If lambda is one, mean RS is 2, 2 minus 1 is 1, degree of A is 1, then of course this particular calculation is sufficient to recover immediately the formula. Here it is, right? Again, we are totally confused. So too many words, too many definitions, even some calculation, right? And then you will get total triviality, 1 plus AQ plus QT. Absolutely a challenge. It was always a challenge, and of course it was quite a challenge for me. Okay, guys, now let me show you maybe quickly, right? Let me show you what happened if there was a breakthrough when we went with Vanya Danilenko from torus nodes to arbitrary iterated nodes here, or to arbitrary iterated means including algebraic nodes here. Okay, so let me show you how it works for a more difficult singularity, but not for torus singularity, at least at level of the formulas here. So here we have the story about quite sophisticated singularity, actually, right? So the corresponding singularity ring is exactly like this, right? And corresponding equation is exactly like this, x equals et cetera, et cetera. So these guys are Newton's pairs here. Okay, so what is definition? I don't need actually evaluation semigroup and stuff like this by now here. Let me skip it completely. So what is this particular singularity? Here it is, right? What is the corresponding algebraic link, actually algebraic node, because it's connected here. Algebraic node is in technical notation, standard framing here, is T32 and then cabling and one more cabling. So quite sophisticated, definitely, right? And here we have exactly explicit description of this particular singularity. Singularities are rings of singularities, one to one. But on the other hand, if you are interested in an explicit formula, here it is an explicit formula in terms of some fractional powers, right? Pretty much standard story from ring to gamma, from gamma to Newton's pairs, from Newton's pairs to the equation here. Okay, but Daha doesn't need anything, needs only these pairs, 3-2 to 1-1 here, only this. For Daha, you replace each and every by the corresponding gamma, gamma, gamma three times here. Then you take the initial guy, depending on lambda, apply the first guy, project. Project means applying to one here, but don't do co-invariant, right? Then again, apply to this polynomial, this guy, right? The second Newton's pair, project. Project apply to one. One more time, project. But then only then take the co-invariant. This is the formula. The formula for arbitrary singularity. You see, for Daha, it is very much business about if you know Newton's pairs or actually know some kind of calculation with continuous fractions here, then you can just do it in a very combinatorial way. Okay, so let me just accelerate a little bit, right, to reach my TVIC story here. But anyway, we're done. Any questions about this particular calculation? Next transparency will be my TVIC story, the beginning of my TVIC story. For the purpose of this particular lecture, my TVIC story is absolutely necessary to explain the extreme simplicity of some formulas, at least for trefoil, right? And I will do it. So anyway, you see, we can manage the next breakthrough, but it was technically more involved, was about links, algebraic links, not about algebraic iterated algebraic nodes, but about algebraic links here. This appeared to be more technical. But still, there is a formula, a nice formula in terms of operations. Operations are, all of them are, you see, in polynomial representation. So Daha, the action of PSL2Z, plus always polynomial representation, application of one, right? So arrow means application of one. Okay, guys, maybe we can really skip it, right? Because my TVIC is exactly the key here, especially because of my introduction. Okay, perfect. So what are standard problems? So what is exactly modern enumerational geometry, if you wish here, right? It is always like this. You take some kind of, in this particular business, let's assume that C is unibranch plane curve singularity. Connected plane curve singularity. Delta is arithmetic genus, which is exactly the dimension of the singularity ring. A bit later, I will give you definitions. This is an introduction to this particular topic here, right? So here we are, right? Let's just take arbitrary rational C, right? Not only a plane curve singularity, but arbitrary rational C. It is always like this. You consider this generating function for Euler heuristics of C to N. For smooth curves, it is really about powers of C. This is McDonald's formula, McDonald's definition of zeta function, and McDonald calculated it easily here for smooth curve. For singular curves, you need to consider, of course, C to N in the sense of Hilbert schemes, ideals of codimension N here, right? C to N means exactly this. Then always, unless you have some whatever more involved algebraic theories, always you employ something like Euler characteristic. This is Euler characteristic, right? Then you need to calculate the corresponding generating series. It is absolutely the same for arbitrary stories, not only about curves, of course. Then step number one, do something to ensure that there will be some coefficients which are integers, right? We need to find some categoric meaning of these coefficients later, right? But right now we need just to make them integers. The trick is sorry, like,
could you please repeat what is E of Cn?
Euler characteristic of C to n. What okay. is C to n? If C is smooth, C to n, symmetric power.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
If C is not smooth, you need to consider ideals of codimension n in C, right? Hilbert scheme, puncture, or whatever. Anyway, Hilbert scheme of points in C to n here, right?
And ideal. Delta and delta does not depend on n, is that right?
Delta is arithmetic genus.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Arithmetic genus is very simple. It is just the dimension of the ring of singularity. I will give the definition later here, explicit definition. Right now, I just use it. Right. So you see in the left hand side, minor tricks. In the right hand side, it is more serious. You need to ensure that the sum is finite. This is infinite sum. But the first lemma is that the sum is finite. Right. This business is well known, at least to Sergei, because of Hilbert schemes of surfaces here. Right. But anyway, it is always the same. Right. But we can do this stuff only for curves and surfaces, but not always error characteristic is, of course, what we want to calculate. Topological error characteristic, just the sum of Betti numbers here, right? Okay, perfect, right? So then with minor trick, the sum is fine, right? Then it is not too difficult, but still you need to prove it that these guys are integers. But always it is quite a challenge in the modern enumerative geometry to prove the positivity. Positivity is always quite a challenge here. Eventually, Vekshende managed it for arbitrary eyes using something different, using this story about Wörsel deformations. Okay, here we are, right? These guys are integers, right? And moreover, these guys are positive integers, non-negative integers. Okay, this is classical approach, right? So ORS conjecture, Oblomkov, Rasmussen-Schendel conjecture is that if you do it properly with some extra algebraic words here, weight filtration is necessary here, you will get Havanov-Razansky stable, not link, but actually, yes, link of C, but C is connected, right? The stable polynomials, uncolored, of course, all of them, there are no colors in this conjecture here. Okay, so the claim was that this particular left-hand side with some parameter T, right, which is because of weight filtration, and with parameter A, because we are doing nested Hilbert schemes, right, sequences of ideals here, right, then it is nothing else but AQT, Havanov-Razansky, stable polynomial. Okay, then with Vanya Danilenko, we conjecture that Daha, uncolored Daha is exactly the same stuff. So the same can be used to the right-hand side is Daha stuff here. Or technically, for instance, the following is corollary of one of our conjectures here. If you consider the following guy, just Betti numbers, consider compactified Jacobian singularities of the singularity here. Then even Betti numbers here, the corresponding series here, the claim that this is exactly Daha polynomial when you kill A, totally A is zero here, and make T one here. It includes von Straten conjecture that even odd Betti numbers are zero for compactified Jacobian, by the way. So here we are, right? A very cheap way to calculate Betti numbers of compactified Jacobian, literally compactified Jacobian from fundamental lemma, of course. The same compactified Jacobian. Right, you just calculate Daha polynomial, kill A, no flex, and make T equals one. Then you'll get Betti numbers. Okay, but now let me go to explicit definitions. I have time. Surprisingly, still, in spite of my attempts to explain what Arnold, why Arnold criticized algebraic, not exactly serious. He tried to make his point, but for me, it took a lot of time to understand what was his point actually. Okay, motivic superpolynomials, all definitions will be provided now, right? Let R be the ring of a unibranch plane curve singularity. Long sentence, but this is very simple. Just a subring with two generators. Very, very simple. Just any subring with two generators inside of this ring of formal series. We consider formal series. It's always in algebraic geometry, right? If you have here double brackets here, right? It means formal series here. Let's consider O, right? C of Z here, and any subring here, right? Subring with two generators. By definition, it is a ring of unibranch, et cetera, here. Okay, clear, right? Immediately there will be examples. I will show you two examples. Torus nodes, of course, and something else. Okay, so what is flecked compactified Jacobian, right? First of all, compactified, okay, flecked compactified Jacobian immediately, right? If it is without flex, then it is just compactified Jacobian from fundamental lemma. Very simple. Consider a flex of modules, right? R modules, right? Inside of O, consider modules here, right? Assume that all of them are R modules, right? They sit inside of O, but they are R modules here. So assume that they are standard. Standard by definition means normalization matter, means that they contain one plus something here. Cannot be too deep inside O here. Consider an element one plus D multiplied by something, right? Then this is just standard property, right? Again, if there are no flex, it is the only property we need. The flex must be complete. The dimensions MI divided by MI minus one must be one always, complete flex here. And C is actually the definition. So because it is complete, that MI is MI minus one plus C to GI, which is unique, of course, right? Some power of Z, right? GI is some power of Z here, plus one plus something here. So this is the definition which follows from B, the definition of GI here, right? And C, which appear to be very important, you need to assume that GI, which are natural numbers, of course, must be increasing, right? This was important, took like 1 year for me and Jan Philip here, just to understand that we need to impose this relation here. But again,
is L fixed?
Sorry?
Is L, the number L, the length of the
flex? Yes. It will be A. Eventually, it will, yeah, absolutely. L is fixed, right?
Okay.
Mm-hmm. To simplify our life, let me assume that L is zero, right? Then you will get a compactified Jacobian, right? There will be A, but no B and C, right? Just consider all standard submodules, right? Submodules in O here, right? This is the definition of compactified, famous celebrated compactified Jacobian of type AN here. Clear, right? Okay, again, L is zero is just fine for this particular talk here, right? But if you want to generalize to get Havana-Frazansky, you need B and C, right? It's very much okay to disregard B and C here. So conjecture, Dahan colored polynomial here, right? Super polynomial is exactly this Mativic guy, right? One line definition. So what is Mativic polynomial? Very, very simple, right? Roughly speaking, the count of flex of modules, right? But once you have a flex, here we have a flex, right? Do the following, A to L is the length of the flex here. When L is zero, there will be no A, right? A is zero here, A to L here. And here, do something non-trivial. Again, it took time for us to understand. Take only the top one, ML, and calculate the dimension, O divided by ML here. So simple, so T is here, A is here, right? A trick question, where is Q? Q is exactly because of count of something over FQ here, right? So here you need to make the field, do the same definition, use the same definition, but now make the ground field, finite field FQ, right? So T because of some dimension, right? A because of the length of the flex here, and Q is exactly for because of non-trivial part. Non-trivial part is counting the flex here over finite field here. So this is Q, right? Of course, this definition is for over arbitrary field. No need to make it C. Make it FQ then.
Vanya, I'm sorry. Is it clear that this dimension is finite?
Oh yeah, good question here. Yes. Because of condition A, dimensions are finite, right? Because condition A, the dimension is no greater than delta. Delta is exactly the dimension of R, exactly the dimension of R here. The dimension of C of Z divided by R here. Oh, sorry for what I'm saying. Yeah.
So delta is the dimension of C of Z mod R, yes?
Delta, let me show you the corresponding definition of delta here a bit later here, right? Yes, to make it absolutely concrete here, right? So probably here. But anyway, what is exactly delta? Delta, you, okay, let me just write it a little bit faster. Next sequence, just give me a second, please. So what is delta, right? Here, when it appeared for the first time, delta is dimension of O divided by R. This is exactly definition. Divided by the ring of singularity, right?
Okay, thank you.
Because of two generators, right? Definitely dimension is finite, right? And then the claim is, let me prove now that the dimension for arbitrary M, the dimension is no greater than delta. Look, so we have M, right? M sits in O, right? If M contains R, right? Then, of course, clearly the dimension is trapped by delta, but we don't assume this, of course, right? But on the other hand, it contains one plus something, right? One plus something, right? And this is absolutely sufficient, right? To prove the same here, that the dimension, because if it contains one plus something, it contains one plus something multiplied by R automatically, right?
Okay, I see the point. Thank you.
Okay. So anyway, it is trapped, right? It is trapped by delta here. Dimension, you're a very legitimate question here. So because of this condition, you see it is exactly the standard condition, right? Because of this condition, right? Dimension is finite.
Fine. I'm sorry, one more question. So in the formula, in the definition of H Mativik, so L ranges, yes? So it's not fixed here.
And now, as you see, of course, the summation is over everything, right? So including L here. Okay. The summation is over L here.
Very good. Thank you.
If you are interested explicitly, for instance, L equals zero, make it, it is very simple. Make A zero, right?
Yeah, I see. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, but anyway, this is exactly how it works. So flex, right? Flex is the only thing which I added to Galkin and Storr definition, by the way, in this story. Oh, anyway, we will discuss it next here. So still I have time. Okay, here we have the definition, right? The key definition, one line definition. And of course I owe you some calculations. We'll do it for trefoil in a moment. Okay, so the beginning of, now let's switch to examples here. For instance, right? So the story about arbitrary, not about trefoil, about arbitrary torus nodes here. Right, so torus node by definition corresponds to the equation x to r equals y to x. What is the corresponding r, right? C, right, or finite field, it is up to us to decide, z to s and z to r here, right? Then immediately the question, so what is the dimension, right? The dimension of O divided by r, right? So I claim this literally Frobenius coin exchange, right? How many coins you can make using S and R exactly, right? And it is well known that it is delta, and the formula is provided R minus one times, this is Sylvester, due to Sylvester here, right? Sylvester proved that the corresponding dimension is R minus one times S minus one divided by two here. Is it obvious? No, it is not, but it is like one page, believe it or not, you know, right? Clear, right? So this is the case of torus nodes, quasi-homogeneous singularities, to be more exact here, right? Quasi-homogeneous singularities, right? Then the calculation is non-trivial, totally combinatorial, and the answer is R minus one times S minus one divided by two. This is delta. For trefoil, of course, one.
Vanya, okay. I'm sorry, how does this formula read if R and S are both even?
Oh, no, GCD one, sorry. We are doing nodes. Yeah. GCD one, of course, right?
No, but it's not. So I mean, for if S is three and R is five. Oh, it's
three minus one times five minus one divided.
It's okay. I see. So you can't have both even.
Only one of them. You're absolutely right. Only one of them can be. But this is not due to me. It is due to Sylvester, right? Okay, guys, and then the question comes. So, what is the number?
No hard computation. There's cert duality, and it follows from cert duality.
For Gorenstein rings, right? This is really some kind of not cert duality, but close enough. Dualization of shift will appear. You're absolutely right. Потом the Duncan guys, it is Sylvester, 18 something, you know, right? This particular formula. Agree, right? All of you understand that I'm just counting gaps, the number of gaps, right? The numbers which cannot be represented using S coin and R coin, right? This is classical answer. Yes, of course, for Gorenstein ring, there are some, the number of gaps. Anyway, I will say a little something if you give me time. Are we done with not trefoil, but with arbitrary torus links? The end of the story. The end of the story that we can count the number of types of standard modules, right? So modules, so what is exactly topological story? Topological story that giving M, giving M, right? So here it is, right? Giving M, you can consider D, which is Z evaluations of M, right? Z evaluations means exactly the leading order of Z here for all the elements here, right? So this will be D here, right? So D is then immediately if gamma is in the same style, gamma is evaluation Z of the whole R, right? I will show you the formula a bit later here. Then immediately you will get the definition of gamma module.
I'm sorry, what is Z?
Z parameter, guys, parameter. Parameter, you remember?
So where
okay. O is C, or it's not Z, C, but anyway, C or FQ, right, of Z. Okay, clear, right? Consider valuations, right? Pretty much classical stuff in the story about singularity, valuations, right? So then for M, we consider D, right? Which is just all valuations, all of them, right? And immediately, because M is submodule, R submodule, immediately you have the following property here, right? Because it is submodule, combinatorial property. This is called gamma module. Gamma module means gamma, of course, semi-group, definitely, right? So what is gamma? Gamma is S, R, then who knows, right? S plus R, 2R to S here, etc. This is gamma, right?
Sorry, I'm a bit lost. What do you call evaluation? So what is?
Okay, what is valuation of Z to S? S, what is valuation of Z to R? R, what is valuation of whatever? Smallest power of Z.
Okay. Okay.
For gamma, S, R, and then 2S, 2R, et cetera, et cetera. But they can be something else, of course.
Mm-hmm.
S plus R, right? All of them, right? Gamma.
Okay.
Right? M is R submodule, right? That's then automatically D plus gamma belongs to D, actually coincides if M contains zero, but you consider only, so valuation of M by definition contains zero. So they just coincide here. This is the definition of gamma module here, right? Again, you can recover in the file, of course, there are explicit definitions, what are semi-group, et cetera, here. Perfect, right? So what is the end of the story? The end of the story is the count of standard D. Standard means that valuation, that this particular D contains zero, right? Because M contains 1 plus Z times something here, right? Then of course valuation, the corresponding valuation will be zero, right? Standard means D contains zero. Then of course there is equality here, not some embedding, but equality here. So then what is the count of standard modules, right? Again, almost Sylvester, right? R slope Catalan number. So it is slope Catalan number, anyway, it's called classical, rational slope Catalan number. Is it due to Sylvester? Not exactly, but close enough to his time, actually, right? So the total number of standard modules is exactly the number of dike paths. Jenny knows them very well, not only Jenny, of course, I believe many of you know them very well. So we count the number of dike paths here. This is the total number of dike paths here. Dike paths are one-to-one with rational slope Catalan numbers here. And they're one-to-one with this D's here, right? Satisfying this encircled condition here. So here we are, right? The count rational slope Catalan number gives you the total number of D. And conclusion that E of the compactified Jacobian, right? of torus knot of this particular R, right, is exactly this particular guy, rational slope Catalan number, right? The first proof was due to Baville, by the way, but he used some different technique. He was advised by Colmes, actually, right? So here we proved, right? There is little technicality to clarify, but we proved that earlier heuristic of computified Jacobian of this thing here is just rational slope Catalan number, exactly this particular formula. Because you remember Chernik Danilenko conjecture, the sum of Betti numbers, this particular guy is exactly the total now. Anyway, in this particular definition, modulo the coincidence conjectures here, right? And of course, there is no A is zero, things are real simple here. So you here we proved our first non-trivial Euler number here of something which is potentially highly singular, actually, computified Jacobian. Okay, if you have no question, practically I'm going to do the same. Next transparency will be with examples here, right? Pretty much the same stuff. Here it is, examples, right? I expected some questions here. So this is the story about trefoil. Let's calculate super polynomial for trefoil. Trefoil, C, Z squared, Z cubed, the simplest possible, right? Gamma, Z plus, when there is only one gap, one missing point here, which is one. Right, one is not available because the first guy are 2, 3, and then all of them will appear, of course. 4, because it's 2 times 2, et cetera, et cetera, right? What is the corresponding gamma? Everything but one. 0, of course, is included. 0, but there is no one. Clear, right? Confirm somehow, right? There is, just say yes, something, please.
Yeah, it's clear, thank you.
Clear, okay. Then let's calculate modules or modules, right? Absolutely no problem. Modules can be invertible. Invertible means principal ideal, 1 plus lambda z here. Lambda is arbitrary from finite field here, of course. Lambda is from finite field, right? Invertibles and just arbitrary invertible modules with one generator, principal ideals, which begins with 1, of course, right? So these are invertibles. How many of them? Q. Q. Invertible modules. And there is one module which is not invertible, which is just O, the whole O with two generators. Right? So only two types of modules, invertibles, Q of them, and one unique module, which is not. All modules are, of course, remember that modules, all of them are sit in O here, right? And all of them contain 1 plus something, 1 plus Z something, right? They are standard. These are modules here. Here we are, right? Either M lambda or just O, the whole thing, right? So what are the standard flex? Can be only like this, M lambda inside O, right? Only one possibility here. So motivic polynomial is 1 for O, then of course dimensions, I just calculate dimensions here, right? This is for O, QT for invertibles, and AQ for one flex, for non-trivial one flex here. Okay, for zero flex, we have 1 plus QT. For one flex, we have AQ, right? Because there is only one flex, one type of flex, M lambda and A. How many M lambdas? Q, so it is A times Q. A is corresponds to the length of the flex here, right? So 1 plus QT plus AQ, immediate, you see, right? So motivic formula works fantastically. And of course, conjecturally, we are calculating Havanov-Razansky polynomial with AQT. Okay, a more interesting example, but now it depends on how much do I have, guys. I can just leave it as such here. Just example of the first non-trivial example when it is non-torus, right? Let me skip it completely now. Otherwise, it can be more than 2 hours, I'm afraid. Igor and Zhenya and Zhenya, what do you think, please?
Skip. Well, whatever you prefer, if you want to skip.
Okay.
Yeah.
So this is the story when compactified Jacobian will be Piankowski calculation will be 23. The corresponding Euler heuristic will be 23, right? Okay, Riemann hypothesis, and we're approaching somehow the end of the story here. Do the following. Consider motivic or Daha superpolynomial. Conjecturally, they coincide, which you remember in terms of Q, T, and A. Motivic or Daha. Conjecture, the conjecture is that they coincide. Just coincide. Uncolored, of course. Do something interesting. Replace the first Q by QT definition. So bold H means motivic when Q, the first parameter here, is replaced by QT here. Technical definition. right? Okay, then because of super duality, which is proven for Daha polynomials, right? For Mativica, it can be proved using whatever, proved for Mativica and from Daha, using absolutely different tools, of course, right? So the corresponding bold H satisfies the following symmetry, right? Which is functional equation. The claim is that if Q remains Q, and then T is replaced by 1 divided by QT, we don't touch A, we don't touch Q. Q is the cardinality of finite field. It cannot be touched here, right? Then it is the same up to some minor rescaling here. So it remains rescaled. Let me refresh, remind if you wish, right? What is the corresponding functional equation for Riemann hypothesis over finite fields here? So let's assume the dimension of X is then smooth, for instance, right? Then the corresponding functional equation is when Q goes to Q, Q is the cardinality of the finite field, you can attach it, but T goes to 1 divided by Q to NT. So classical functional equation is exactly, which can be proven using a standard Grothendieck program, whatever, cohomologies. Here N is 1, so here it is, right? In the same style, if you, upon this renormalization, if you change, if you don't touch Q, but change T to 1 divided by QT here, it is essentially the same, up to some renormalization. This is superduality, we call it superduality. This is not the action of PSL2Z, this is something different, guys. This is functional equation. Perfect, right? So what is the, then because of a reality argument, et cetera, you have the following. So if you have a zero zeta in terms of T, so Q cannot be touched. Q is the cardinality, right? So we only can only play with T. Let's consider T zeros of this particular guy H, right? H of course depends on A, so we need to kill A. You can consider H zero, just constant term, or H one, the coefficient of A, et cetera, et cetera. Let me focus on H zero. H zero means you kill A, no flex here, right? So then automatically because of functional equation, if Xi is a zero, right, of Hi, then the following guy, here, if Xi is a zero, right, then one divided by Qxi is a zero as well, right? Then because of reality argument, Xi bar is the same here. So we obtain that potentially it is possible that the absolute value of Xi is just const square root of 1 divided by Q here. This is Riemann hypothesis. Riemann hypothesis that all of them belong to the unit circle, not exactly to the unit circle, the radius is exactly given by this formula here. Okay, if I spell it for whatever zeta functions here, it will be Riemann hypothesis upon some renormalization. Perfect, right? So what is in this business? For polynomials, we are doing only polynomials, right? Technically, they are called zeta polynomials if they satisfy functional equation. So for this zeta polynomials, the source is our super polynomials, Daha super polynomials, or Mativic super polynomials, right? Conjecture is that for some range of Q from zero to some number kappa here, right? Riemann hypothesis holds. Let's focus only on H zero. So only on H zero. Perfect, right? Not too difficult to prove that for sufficiently small Q, here definitely is not of arithmetic nature here. So Q is cardinality. Cardinality, you cannot play with cardinality of the finite field here. But here we already assume part of the conjectures that the dependence on Q is uniform. So Q is just a parameter for us. Moreover, the dependence on Q is polynomial here. Just all conjectures, sometimes they can be proven, of course, but mostly they are conjectures here, right? So the claim is that if you allow Q to be a parameter, free parameter, that Riemann hypothesis began to hold when Q is smaller than one, definitely. So exact conjecture that the bound is 1/2 here, exactly. So if Q is smaller than 1/2, that for whatever singularities, plane curve singularities, the Riemann hypothesis holds. So all zeros are exactly where they are supposed to be. Okay, any questions here? I'm supposed to stop with links here. No, we'll not discuss links here. Again, Mativic or Daha replace Q by QT. Then the corresponding superduality will be just a classical way substitution T to 1 divided by QT. H is unchanged up to some rescaling here, right? Then the claim is that the corresponding zeros all belong to the corresponding unit circle here of radius 1 divided by q square root. Any questions here? Please. Guys, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yes.
Okay. Perfect, right? So conjecture, so Galkin store, right? I definitely need to mention a little something about the definition. What is their definition, right? Their definition in terms of ideals. So my definition was in terms of modules, right? Their definitions were was in terms of straight Hilbert schemes, in terms of ideals.
Vanya, what is R ideal?
Well, very, very simple. Ideals in R, just ideals, right?
Okay.
Ideals in R, right? R modules make sense, but now we consider R ideals in R here, right? Ideals are nice because you don't
need Galkin and Stor is that Galkin had ideals, but Stor had modules.
No. Galkin Stor, Stor didn't introduce this stuff. It is due to Galkin. Stor just proved some interest.
Galkin had ideals, that's clear, but I saw that Stor introduced
Galkin, Abloomkov, Schende, Rasmussen, they all are doing ideals. Hilbert for them are ideals, right? If you want to capture competitive Jacobian, you need to consider modules, R modules.
Okay.
This is the passage to, this is non-trivial. Competitive Jacobian is not connected directly with Hilbert schemes. You need to do something here. So fundamental conjecture, right? It is only for plane curve singularities, not for arbitrary Gorenstein rings here. Is that if you do this definition, again, one line definition, everything is very simple here. So what is Galkin's zeta function, right? Look at this particular guy, very similar. So M is in R, as I already mentioned, they're inside R. You don't need to consider uniformization or whatever here, right? Then you do literally the same, flex as always, right? Whatever technical standardizable, et cetera, here. Then look what happens here. A to L in the same style here. T, dimension of what? Used to be O divided by M here. Now it is R divided by ML, the top guy in this leg here, right? Anyway, you count ideals, flex of ideals generally, right? When A to L is the length of the flex, can be just one here, right? Can be just zero, right? If there are no flex here. And here you naturally you divide R by what? By the top M here, right? The corresponding dimension. This is the definition. This is zeta function, which is infinite, right? But if you multiply it by one minus T, you will get finite. This is the definition of L function, Galkin's Stor or Galkin's L function here, right? Then, of course, you can prove using Tate's trick, but Stor found a very nice combinatorial proof. You can prove that it's a satisfied functional equation. Functional equation, here functional equation is when t goes to one divided by qt. Same as in algebraic geometry, right? So, and then of course, Galkin observed that Riemann hypothesis, of course, failed, et cetera, here. But anyway, conjecture, right? And I'm almost done. The rest will be just informal discussion. So conjecture. That motivic H, right, which is can be based on Daha because conjecture they coincides with L. L function coincides with motivic. This guy is in terms of competitive Jacobian. This guy is in terms of Hilbert scheme here, but they coincide. Coincide only for plane curve singularities. This is not a general fact. But on the other hand, something calls for arbitrary Gorenstein R's here, right? But I mentioned what actually. Let me skip it completely. So here it is. The connection, right? Fundamental connection. Still, I cannot prove it. I know many things about this stuff here. Still, cannot prove this particular conjecture, right? Which establishes the link between competitive Jacobian and Hilbert schemes. Okay. Any questions here, right? Again, what is the logic?
Is the conjecture known for A equals zero?
Oh yeah, not exactly. So this is exactly the cases when you can calculate the corresponding. Anyway, for quite a few examples.
So because even for even for A equals zero, it's not known.
Even
right?
For torus knots, I cannot prove it actually. Even for torus knots, when I have a lot of technical tools.
For torus knots and a equals zero, you cannot prove, yes?
Yeah, well, I just mentioned a couple of calculations on what is exactly the limit of calculations. Quite involved from the viewpoint of algebraic geometry, right? But still, you see calculations are somewhat involved if you calculate L functions or bold H functions. Mativic are very simple to calculate for torus knots and similar, right? But on the other hand, generally, I use my programs for Daha superpolynomials for general, especially for colored cases. Of course, they are much faster. I mean, technique based on Daha. Again, conjecture. Daha coincides with Mativic superpolynomials. Mativic superpolynomials coincide with Galkin's L functions. Exactly, right? And here we have a lot of absolutely solid conjectures, but definitely we have a lot of missing links here. Okay, so if it is okay with you, right? So let me do the following. Let me completely skip. Okay, let me say a little something because it seems that I have little time here. So then physics of the story here, right? This is very interesting. What is Mativic? So the claim is that super polynomials we constructed are partition functions of Landau-Ginzburg topological Landau-Ginzburg theory, period, right? So if you can, what is Landau-Ginzburg theory? The case of dimension one, you consider superpotentials, Wx. Anyway, for those who know this business, I believe some definitely know, this is Coulomb branch here, right? Close to quiver varieties. So you begin not with superconformal field theory, right? Classical stuff for us, Kasmoudi algebras, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera here. Affine flag varieties, but you begin with superpotential, right? Superpotential is WXY. In this particular talk, it is just an arbitrary polynomial, but only we will consider only this particular polynomial as the equation of singularity, right? So let's consider this particular guy, polynomial in terms of two variables here, right? Then you consider the corresponding Landau-Ginzburg theory, right? Very simple to introduce, at least the beginning of this theory is very simple. So what are the choices here? You can consider u squared plus wxy, right? In terms of uxy, or uv plus wxy here. Generally, of course, you are supposed to consider w of x, y, z, but no greater than this. Maybe in terms of four, but no greater than this. This equation is Calabi-Yau, actually. Uv plus wxy, classical Waffe digraph equals zero. Waffe digraph singularity or Calabi-Yau variety. But anyway, there's Knorr periodicity of singularities, very absolutely relevant stuff, but let me skip it completely. But anyway, choices, right? Classical physics choices in physics papers are WXY, right? Then this particular guy or this particular guy here, still based on the same polynomial. Okay, so of course, superpotentials can appear in many businesses. For Knizhnik-Zamolodchikov, there is some formula for superpotential, et cetera, here. But anyway, here we have classical LGSM, Landau-Ginzburg SM equivalence to superconformal field theory, right? So this is, of course, LGSM part of the story. Okay, so what is the beginning? The beginning is extremely simple. So first of all, you consider R. You consider R, the corresponding R, right? It will be just C of xy, serious or not serious, divide by two partial derivatives, right? Divide by two. This is called the ring of singularity here, right? The ideal generated, well, let me just make it formal. This is the ring of singularity here, right? Xy divided by wx, finite field. Just the ring of singularity. Okay, so the dimension of this guy, this is exactly what we called O divided by R here, right? This is the ring of singularity. The dimension of this guy is delta, exactly our delta here. Okay, so physically, so what this particular thing here is the algebra, commutative algebra of chiral operators. This is the beginning of Landau-Ginzburg theory, first. Second, according to Witten, if you multiply by two delta, this is the number of particles, bosons and fermions here. Right. Third, C efficient can be defined, CF effective or efficient here, right? There is a formula for torus knots only, but there is a formula for arbitrary singularity. So physics CF in the corresponding theory, mu is exactly the formula which we know very well for torus knots here. You remember R minus one times S minus one divided by two. It was for delta, now it will be like this Milner number of this particular ring of singularity. Perfect, right? So CF, then you define physically what is a C, central charge here, and there is a formula, right? Very similar to the classical formulas for Virasoro algebra, et cetera, et cetera. But the source is six, of course, is not by chance here. But the source here is absolutely different. Just straightforward definition of what is C here, right? And then you calculate the formula. More or less, it is what they did in the old papers here. Nick Warner here, 1982 here, et cetera, et cetera. Then mostly they stopped. Now we can absolutely, we need to refresh it. Because the claim is that if you continue, you can calculate the whole partition function of this particular story. The whole partition function of topological Landau-Ginzburg sigma module is exactly our super polynomial when A is zero or something here. Okay, this is how we can, well, this is of course very much motivic. You need to go to a modular stating here, finite field here, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, and now let me show you something which I promised, otherwise I would skip it, right? What is the physics meaning of Riemann hypothesis? So what I'm going to do, I'm going to skip completely the story about Witten index. So what we really do here and just show you the last transparencies, right? We're practically done. Sorry for this, right? And this is important because we all, of course, respect string theories, but mostly we're more comfortable, I believe, with integrable modules, all of us, right? Including those who are doing Kasmudi, et cetera, here, right? Because the whole story is somehow about integrability, about integrable modules, about ferromagnets and stuff like this, about easing module here. So let me show you. So the closest possible example of two Riemann hypothesis, at least in this particular talk, is exactly Li Yang theorem here. And because of this, we have some insight, physics insight. At last, what can be, what which physics meaning can be expected for the classical, so to say, so-called grand conjectures, the grand Riemann hypothesis here. Okay, let me spell what people are doing in the story about Ising model here. So first of all, you have H Hamiltonian, right? Pretty much standard Hamiltonian Ising model anyway, right? Can be a one dimensional, two dimensional, whatever, in arbitrary dimensions here, right? Square lattice is pretty much classical here. So N and the prime means neighbors, of course, right? So sigma is plus minus classical Ising model here, not post model, but classical Ising models here. J are const, interaction constant here, right? Here we have classical Hamiltonian, right? For lattice square, the story is integrable. A lot of stuff, of course, about this, right? But here it is not necessary to assume that it is in dimension two here. Okay, so clear it is, right? And then we do the following. To get really physics stuff here, you need external magnetic field. So you add linear term. This is quadratic, classical Ising model here. Then here we add the corresponding external magnetic field. So Sasha Zamolochikov informed me that he wasted almost 10 years in attempt to prove that with this particular H, it is integrable. So it is not. Not exactly, he was doing many other important things, I believe. But he just mentioned that all his attempts, right, to prove that with this H extension, the problem is integrable, failed completely. So it is not integrable, right? Without H, it is integrable. Of course, for square lattice. If it is about space, it is, of course, there are a bunch of very important deep results, conjectures, whatever. Any questions here? Guys, just confirm that you are still with me.
We are.
Good. So Ising model, right? And prime means neighbors, right? Neighbors in a lattice, in a square lattice, for instance, right? Sigma plus minus, right? Okay, so this is exactly the definition of Hamiltonian. Then you do the following. You consider Z, the formula is here, right? Beta is pretty much classical stuff here, KB, anyway, Boltzmann constant, whatever here, right? So beta, right? T is temperature, et cetera, et cetera. Actually, viscosity in this business, right? But anyway, it doesn't matter, some parameter here, right? So here we have Z, the summation over the states, E to minus beta H, HN means all of them, right? Eta minus B energy here, right? The summation Z, right? Z again, we have long discussions with Sasha Zmalochka here, not only with him here. So Z is non-physical. So what is physical? Lim is physical. He mentioned that all attempts to make it somehow reasonable before taking the limit are absolutely, anyway, there are no chances. You need really to consider the limit when n goes to infinity, the limit of this particular guy here. So this is physics. If there are questions, go ahead, please. Okay, so here we are. So we have two parameters. Let me introduce new parameters here in terms of the stuff which I introduced. U is exp j here, mu is exp h, minus minus two times here. So we assume that j, mathematically, we assume that j is greater or equal than zero and beta is greater than zero here. Yes, of course, beta is a constant, right? And j, with j, it is not so obvious that we can assume that it is zero, but let's assume that j are all zero, all non-negative here. Okay, so assumption, right? Let's assume that impose this particular two things here. So we have two parameters of the theory, right? Mu and u here, right? Then, because of absolutely, so to say, stupid reasons here, if you change sigma by minus sigma, right, it will be the same theory. Because here it is quadratic, no change. Here, sigma will change to minus sigma and h will take to h. So here we are. So we have a very cheap perturbation, right, or whatever, right? Functional equation when mu goes to 1 over mu. Because if you change h here to minus h, then mu will go to 1 over mu. Then accordingly, possible expectation is that all zeros, which zeros? Mu zeros of h or, oh, sorry, of z, of z, let's discuss only z at the moment, right? So you consider z and try to say something reasonable about zeros of z, zeros of z in terms of mu. So the theorem due to Li and Yang, not too difficult to prove here, but with nice proof here, is that all zeros belong to the unit circle under these inequalities. Under these inequalities, all zeros, here it is the picture, right? All zeros belong to yellow unit circle here. Okay, so what is the physics meaning of this? Very important stuff, actually. Because physics theory is, of course, zeros can be, of course, complex. You see, mostly they are complex. There is only one zero when mu is one, which is not complex here, right? Complex zeros are absolutely not physical. There is no question about it. Only real line here matters here. So physics theory exists literally if and only if it has only one phase transition. This is definitely zeros are phase transitions. Why they are phase transitions? Because of log z here. Log z here gives you some singularity. So here we have phase transition. So physically speaking, when there is only one real zero, when it is one, there is only one phase transition, which is exactly at this particular point one here, which makes perfect sense because physics theory cannot have two phase transitions normally, right? Of course, there are some cases when there are finitely many of them, but still mostly expect only reasonable phase transitions. There can be from gas to liquid, from liquid to whatever, to solid here, but not so many of them. So, and there is an interesting proof to prove that the theory is physical. They prove that all zeros are complex unless mu equals zero, meaning that there is only one phase transition, which is exactly at mu equals zero. Real zero can be only one here. You can say that this is quite a strange way to prove it. Maybe there are some other ways. Why we need to prove it? They exactly belong to the unit circle. Okay, let me say a little something to the end. I have, I believe, one minute here. So why it is at least morally closely related to what I discussed before? We have some extension. Let's do something strange, non-physical. Let's consider u, this is u, which becomes negative, which are now allowed to be negative, somewhat negative at least here. This is non-physical, of course, because here we have exp of something, you know, right? Negativity is out of the question. Then something must be complex here, right? But still, physically, in physics paper, they performed some experiments. They just made u from a little bit negative. Small negative, but small negative here. And they proved that still this property holds. This property that all zeros belong to the yellow circle holds unless u is smaller than some negative u critical here. Anyway, in the neighborhood of zero, right? So still it holds here. And then they found U critical, literally my kappa, literally. So I found some kappa in terms of Q. In terms of U, they found this particular guy here. And then they provided some tools. They didn't do this, but I did. They provided some tools to analyze what happened if you go through critical U critical here. The story is like this. So first of all, it is well known that if it is about classical zeta, then if there are some zeros which don't obey the Riemann hypothesis here, then they always appear in pairs, of course, right? Because of reality, because there are two symmetries, classical symmetries, functional equation, and of course, the reality symmetry here. So they always appear in pairs here. Here it is absolutely the same, that if something is wrong, that zeros will appear in pairs, right? So automatically there will be not just one more zero, but two more zeros automatically, just because of the reality of the zeta function, classical reality of zeta function. So what happens here? Same happens here. And moreover, we need to do the limit. And then practically it means that if you take U somewhat smaller than U critical, it will be not just two of them, two unwanted phase transitions, which is already quite bad actually. But there will be the whole segment of phase transitions. So the story is the story or the theory is absolutely non-physical. So here we are, right? So Riemann hypothesis, exactly sharp belonging to this rules to the unit circle, is more or less equivalent to the absence of some crazy phase transitions here. And you need exactly this particular property. If it is just more or less like if there are some deviations, even minor deviations, then in the limit, especially in the limit, there will be total mass here. Okay, so what are expectations now in the end of my talk here? Expectations is that if you go to surface singularities, not to plane curve singularities, but to surface singularities, then we expect that you will get Dirichlet L functions. Exactly motivic super polynomials will become Dirichlet with Q possibly, but anyway, will become Dirichlet L functions, at least morally, right? And then we have Riemann hypothesis. So presumably the corresponding physics theory for W, X, Y, Z, right, with three axes here, right, exists, makes sense if and only if the corresponding L function is again presumably conjectural or whatever, just wishful thinking sometimes, right? Presumably is exactly Landau-Ginzburg, motivic Landau-Ginzburg partition function here. So exactly this particular Z. So they claim that if it doesn't obey Riemann hypothesis, that something happens with the corresponding physics theory at level of phase transitions. They become crazy, literally crazy. Okay, thank you very much. Sorry for these 2 hours. Not what I promised. Any questions?
Thank you very much, Ваня.
Thank you.
So are there any questions? А, наверное, можно по-русски, да, теперь?
Да, конечно, безусловно.
Вроде англоговорящих у нас нету. Какие-нибудь вопросы?
Это все-таки, наверное, я прослушаю. А почему они мотивные?
Так, стоп, секундочку. Значит, мы давайте-ка вернемся сейчас туда, куда нужно. Значит, сейчас мы уходим с этой мистической деятельности про физику. Да? Мотивные кто? Ландау-Гинзбург или мотивные?
Накащены.
А, почему я называю их мотивными? Сейчас мы это дело проясним. Значит, сейчас мы идем с самого начала. Значит, мотивные, мотивик суперполиномиалс. Отлично. Угу,
да. И почему супер, это второй вопрос, ну да.
Что такое вообще мотив? Мотивы это не совсем то же самое. Мы определяем, так сказать, мотивное кольцо, а то, что я делаю, подсчет точек по модулю P, это мотивные меры. У нас на мотивном кольце, Гротендиковском там кольце и так далее, мотивное кольцо, это действительно мотивное кольцо, у него есть мотивные меры. Основная мотивная мера, которую мы обычно рассматриваем, это как раз в точности взятие точек по модулю P. Вообще говоря, мотивные меры, их на самом деле много, могут быть совершенно другие, потому что мотивное кольцо – это просто абстрактная вещь, это Гротендиковское кольцо, там оно называется Alch over C, K, Alch over C. Значит, что такое мотивное? Мотивное – это значит, что мы рассматриваем мотивы. Мотивы – это просто элементы в пространстве многообразия over C, просто, которые удовлетворяют свойства аддитивности. Это функция, вот, если you consider products и объединения, у вас эта функция должна удовлетворять некоторым обычным свойствам. Теперь взятие подсчет точек по модулю P – это, очевидно, аддитивная функция. Если у вас объединение двух многообразий, то, естественно, конечно, это особенно важно, когда вы сигма-процессы делаете, то, естественно, конечно, количество точек будет сумма точек слева и сумма точек справа. Вот это и более-менее определение мотивной меры. Но есть кольцо, специальное кольцо. Alch over C, как оно называется? Кай. Кай. Вар C. Вот something like this. Вот это кольцо как раз в точности аксиоматизация свойств вот этой функции, что union, additive по отношению к unions. И еще, конечно, есть там какие-то свойства, но стандарт, главное свойство, это, конечно, additivity есть. Так вот, взятие точек по модулю P – одна из мотивных мер, но не единственная. Есть геометрические, связанные с тем, что вы теорию когумологии берете, значит, здесь подсчет точек FQ. Значит, то, что я делал, это, безусловно, не в самом кольце, а, безусловно, после взятия меры. Но если я делаю само кольцо, здесь то же самое можно все сделать. Например, Шенде и компания, Шенде, Гетшен, Шенде, да обязательно у них вторая часть статьи, обязательно они это делают на мотив, на полном кольце. Значит, в полном кольце у нас есть там или один генератор, или один проективная прямая, то есть активная афинная прямая и так далее, и так далее, и так далее. Значит, утверждается, что все можно вычислить, если вы знаете, что такое A1, афинная, одномерная афинная кривая, то вы все можете вычислить в терминах A1. Так вот, теорема о том, что у нас, то сам не теорема, а, по крайней мере, гипотеза о том, что это strong polynomial count, considered compactified Jacobian FQ, strong polynomial count, что это выражается как polynom от Q. Мотивный вариант состоит в том, что можно эту штуку с помощью всяких сигма-процессов, бог знает чего еще, можно выразить, когда у вас будет комбинация, где только A1 разрешается, A1 или степень A1. То есть есть некое разрешение особенности этой жуткой штуки, такое, что всегда все слои будут A1 или A2 или A3 и так далее, и так далее. Это буквально означает, что формула зависит от Q uniformly для любого Q. Значит, теорема о том, что теорема expectation, это strong polynomial count, в точности означает, что я могу эффективно описать вот этот вот объект. Давайте я покажу вот этот объект. Могу его описать эффективно с помощью сигма-процессов, как более или менее как сумма в кольце Гротендика, как сумма A to N here. A to N – это Q в степени N here. Вот, оказывается, что на самом деле я делаю. Я утверждаю, что эта штука имеет некое экономическое описание, not over Q.
Ну, то есть это какое-то обобщение клеточного разбиения, да, тут только коэффициента нет.
Отличный point. Если есть клеточное разбиение, это гарантированно. Если есть настоящий CW, если это CW комплекс, конечно, это гарантированно. Но это более тонкая вещь, конечно, потому что
там была гипотеза неверная. Лунца, что там можно подразбить, как бы, если две штуки равны, но она неверна. Геометрии примешивают, что ты как бы можешь сложить как бы эти системы, чтобы совпали.
Правильно. Так вот, для торических узлов, конечно, у нас есть это. Это стандартное разбиение, не тривиальное, но тем не менее оно, конечно, есть. Для торических именно узлов, конечно, там есть квазихомогенность сингулярность, там есть action C-star here. Это Берула-Брилинский более или менее дает нам клеточное разбиение. Значит, у нас есть клеточное разбиение. Раз есть клеточное разбиение, история закончена. Конечно, это сумма каких-то степеней Q. Потому что одна клетка – это Q в степени U. Но вообще говоря, лучше в кольцо Гротендика уходить, потому что там не нужно никаких предположений о том, что есть клеточное разбиение. Теперь клеточное разбиение тоже есть для произвольных сингулярностей, но значительно более сложной природы. Они посчитаны в наших статьях в довольно сложных примерах. Что там может быть на самом деле? Так что, в принципе, если нет C-star звездочки, абсолютно нет никаких причин ожидать клеточное разбиение. Когда есть действие C-star, это просто теорема, потому что есть полное клеточное разбиение. Это торические узлы, я не знаю, тут зависит от того, что вам нужно. Если комбинаторика интересует, то торические узлы больше, чем достаточно. У нас там есть всякие там теоремы, связи очень, очень глубокие, на самом деле. Есть shuffle conjecture, или как там называется, в общем, разные, которым Антон недавно доказал, Антон Мелит доказал. Ну, комбинаторные доказательства. Значит, куча комбинаторики, связанная с торическими узлами. Но если это не торические узлы, в принципе, нужно, конечно, совершенно произвольные особенности делать в этом бизнесе. Тогда, конечно, надо как-то считать, никто точно не знает, как считать диклеточные разбиения.
Спасибо.
Спасибо, хороший вопрос.
Еще какие-нибудь вопросы, комментарии?
Комментарии.
Я про мотивные могу сделать комментарий, просто что это
Концевич. Пожалуйста, да.
В середине 90-х придумал Концевич название, потом раскрутили. Но на самом деле, а еще Дринфильд придумал название, что кольцо Гротендика – это мотивы для бедных. Но на самом деле они, во-первых, не мотивы, как мы сейчас знаем, во-вторых, не для бедных. То есть там в мотивах там соответствие, как если у вас две штуки там между ними какое-то соответствие, они равны. Здесь это не так. А с другой стороны, здесь можно находить такие тонкие вещи, как там персональные типы, а в мотивах там наоборот бывает, что что-то общего типа, такой же мотив, как что-то типа фан. То есть, ну, в общем, это дурацкое название, его придумали в 90-х, потому что еще многого не знали, как бы, а теперь оно, к сожалению, осталось.
Я согласен, я, на самом деле...
Я просто обычно пишу вот кольцо протендика, там, для реализации.
Да, правильно. На самом деле,
все-таки... Которая пропускается через канолит мотивов, там есть такое отображение из канолит многообразия, канолит мотивов, а дальше из него. Вот. Это вот, по-честному, была бы мотивная мера. Но концентричка в середине 90-х, он думал, что это одно и то же. Ну, вообще, многие люди примерно до середины 10-х годов думают, что одно и то же, из-за этого такая путаница возникла, вообще говоря, разница большая.
Спасибо. Это не то, чтобы это путаница, на самом деле тут действительно, на самом деле мотивы связаны с группой Галуа. Мотивы – это замена группы Галуа, настоящей абсолютной группы Галуа, такой штукой. Это нечто совместимое с Танаки-Крейменскими тензорными категориями, некое специальное определение мотивной группы Галуа, которая никакая не группа Галуа, нечто, сохраняющее тензорное произведение. Вот это настоящий мотив, с моей точки зрения. Правильно?
Хорошо. Не, просто мотив... когда я говорю, что если у вас есть отображение из этого кольца куда-то, морфизма, вот они бывают, которые пропускаются через мотивы, а бывают, которые не пропускаются.
Понял, да, все совершенно разно, все абсолютно.
Раньше не знали, что бывают те, которые не пропускаются, но уже лет 20 назад придумали очень сильные такие морфизмы, которые там персональной геометрии, наоборот, полезны. А мотивы сами по себе бесполезны. Ну, их не умно использовать.
Теперь, что здесь существенно, что здесь несущественно? Очень существенно, что это strong polynomial count, потому что иначе я ничего не могу сделать. Если это зависит, мне нужно, чтобы это от Q зависело юниформно. Мне, конечно, вполне хватает вот этой штуки, Гротенниковского кольца, вполне хватает.
Это гораздо более сильное утверждение, да, что оно будет полиномом.
А что нужно следующий уровень? Это Шенде и Гетше. Им бы хотелось иметь эффективное разрешение особенностей компактизированного якобиана. Это, конечно, очень интересно. В смысле, что там такое появляется и как появляется. Это куда более тонкая вещь, конечно. Но, с другой стороны, даже точно знать, что там какого-то вроде клеточного разбиения есть, даже это очень нетривиально. Но это уже другой разговор. Это серьезная алгебраическая геометрия. А мне вот для того, что я вам рассказывал, безусловно, достаточно, что зависит от Q единообразно. Но это очень сильное свойство на самом деле, потому что таких вот rational count многообразий, они почти все практически бирациональны, не только почти все, наверное, все бирациональные. В общем, их очень, конечно, мало. Есть железные, обычно это результат сигма-процессов 1, 2, 5, там, не знаю, 25, что-нибудь в этом духе. Тогда, конечно, там будет от Q будет зависеть единообразно, ровно потому что это через K var C here. Просто чтобы было яснее. Я продолжаю.
Известно, что они стабильно рациональны, но про рациональность это открытый вопрос.
Правильно. Совершенно.
Многие из них очевидно, что рациональны, если у вас есть клетка, то ничего, все.
Правильно, если клетки есть, конец истории, да. Но, к сожалению, здесь, если нет действия СИСТАР, к сожалению, нет никаких оснований ожидать, что будет клеточное разбиение хоть какое-то. Но гипотезы проверены сильно-сильно для очень-очень общих неторических узлов. Все еще гипотезы, абсолютно все гипотезы выполняются, нет никаких сомнений. А вот почему, это уже другой разговор. То, что эта штука юниформно зависит от Q и многое-многое другое. Вот это, конечно, то самое энное количество гипотез. Сейчас по последней статье я это связываю уже с гибридными схемами на C2 и так далее. В общем, нам кое-что можно сделать. Например, никто меня не спрашивал, но это нетривиально доказать, что вот эта вот штука, вот смотри, здесь мы имеем определение, простое определение мотивного суперполинома. Так вот, гипотеза, что эта штука зависит только от топологического типа. Это совершенно нетривиально, потому что на самом деле это зависит от алгебраической геометрии. Определение, которое я вам дал, конечно, зависит от алгебраической геометрии. Но вот утверждается, что оно зависит только от топологического типа сингулярности. Я это доказал для торических узлов пока, ну и для некоторых других случаев. Даже для торических узлов это совершенно нетривиально, потому что у торических узлов, вообще говоря, есть аналитические деформации нетривиальные, начиная с 9-10 примерно. Там у них есть очень нетривиальная и красивая теория аналитической деформации. Так вот, на самом деле, вот это определение действительно только от топологического типа зависит. Но я уже не отвечаю на вопрос, а просто добавляю что-то.
Спасибо. Еще комментарии? Ну хорошо, а если нету, тогда, Ваня, спасибо тебе большое, очень интересно.
Спасибо, спасибо большое, спасибо, огромное спасибо за комментарий, информативный комментарий.
Ну, вопрос, вот у вас там Хованов-Розанский появлялся, но вы потом его как-то замяли. Вот, вот, у вас есть про этот слайд поподробнее?
Давай сейчас попробуем. Точно какой вопрос? А что такое Хованов-Розанский?
Значит, там слева, а справа Хованов-Розанский, да?
Вот буквально.
Смотри,
вот, давай возьмем вот это первое место. Вот у нас есть ДХ суперпленум. Одна клеточка означает некрашенный. Это значит, что самое минискульный вес, только один минискульный вес. АКЮТИ берется. Некрашенный. Так вот, гипотеза о том, что это стабильный Хованов-Розанский. Что такое стабильный? Это не очень приятная штука, потому что для каждого конкретного N там появляются дифференциалы. Так вот, это то, что для A infinity, так сказать, которое стабильное, без взятия дифференциалов. Значит, стабильный Хованов-Розанский – это в точности от A к T. Или triply graded еще их называют. Еще triply graded Humphrey PT, например, их называют иногда. В точности совпадает с некрашенным ДХ AQT. А также совпадает с мотивик AQT, флаговый, а также совпадает с галкинской зета-функцией, тоже мотивной, L-функцией. Вот, пожалуйста, некрашенная история. Крашенная история, тут ДХ вне конкуренции, если это крашено произвольным весом. Хованов-Розанский просто почти невозможно ничего там посчитать. Значит, здесь у нас есть материал для Torus Iterated Link Sphere, для произвольных крашенных. Значит, ответил я на вопрос. Значит, Хованов любой
одной природы получается. Слева что-то алгебраическое, справа как бы Хованов-Розанский тоже там. Вы используете комбинаторику там вот этого, не знаю, диаграммы, наверное, да, и тоже там пишете какой-то матричной факторизации, там строите какие-то полиномочки, да?
Безусловно, самое лучшее определение на сегодняшний день, если, конечно, есть модули Сёргеля, но самое хорошее определение – это как раз матричная факторизация, безусловно, самое разумное. Так вот здесь, ну, матричная факторизация, это в каком-то смысле, но я это не делал никогда, это в каком-то смысле то, что я вам рассказывал про Ландау-Гинзбурга, на самом деле. Тоже пишется матричная факторизация, потенциал, то есть связи там, я не случайно я кноровскую периодичность, сингулярность я упомянул, потому что это в точности вот оттуда как раз. Но это кто-то должен делать.
Значит, есть, конечно. Параметр есть n, там они типа используют функцию x в степени n, потом из нее там делают более сложные функции.
А здесь правильно, нет, ну в вычислительном плане это страшно неприятно. Посчитайте, кроме 2n плюс 1, это еще Миша Хованов посчитал, для 2n плюс 1 таврический узлов. Очень трудно считать, необычайно сложно считать Хованов.
В плане просто как определяется через что.
Это определяется, очень похоже на теорию Ландау-Гинзбурга. Никто по этой дороге никто не следовал, на самом деле. Нужно там продумать.
Как бы берем комбинаторику от этого зацепления, да, а потом из него делаем какую-то алгебраическую штуковину, да, и у нее что-то считаем, гомологическую.
Совершенно точно. Некий комплекс сложный, и считаем у него нечто там. Некие triply graded гомологии считаем у него. Безусловно, так оно ровно есть. И самая лучшая техника, как ни странно, очень похожа, по крайней мере, по словам, на Ландау-Гинзбурга. Тоже некий суперпотенциал, который матричный, для матричной факторизации потенциал используется. Это, в общем, более-менее используется в некоторых работах, но это самое, конечно, не на таком уровне. То, что я вам рекламирую, это другая линия, это чисто алгебраическая теория. Во-первых, ДХ – это чисто алгебраическая теория, а во-вторых, мотивная – тоже чисто алгебраическая. Ну, подсчет точек каких-то, если есть клеточное разбиение, даже и точки не надо считать, и так все ясно на самом деле. Вот это все просто.
Как доказывать гипотезу?
Гипотеза? Нет, значит, давайте, что точно известно. Антон Мелит, давайте точно скажу. Антон Мелит, то, что он сделал там по поводу этой shuffle convection, это более или менее он доказал, что только для таврических узлов стандартные, вот то, что вы говорите, Хованово-Розанские, стандартные, только для таврических узлов, не крашеные, совпадают с конструкцией через ДХ. Значит, ДХ дает то же самое. Значит, он это делал комбинаторно, то, что вы говорите, переписывал комбинаторно то сам Хованова-Розанского, наконец переписал так, чтобы стало ясно, что это примерно моя конструкция, которую я вам сегодня в самом начале показывал, как считать суперполиномы через ДХ. Вот он примерно ровно этот метод и переобнаружил. Оказалось, что частный случай этой штуки – это shuffle conjecture, это совпадение. Это все, что мы знаем, только про таврические узлы и только с некрашенной и так далее, и так далее, и так далее. Но и тоже надо сказать, что это доказательство чисто комбинаторное. Он очень сильный парень, но вы знаете, наверное, его. Он считал и досчитал, конечно. Вот такой досчитает, такой, конечно, досчитает. Но, в общем, это не сильно прояснение. Значит, мы с ним общались, он мне там все показывал. Но в точности один к одному это вычисление, которое я вам показал. Он показал, что это вычисление, как раз вычисление с помощью этих комплексов, которые мы уже немножко упомянули. Вычисление через некоммутативные полиномы, полиномы Е. Но это не крашеный случай, где много-много все проще, конечно. В крашеном случае мало чего известно про Хованова-Розанского, хотя определение сейчас уже получено. Определение. Долгое время их не могли получить. То же самое и с Линкс тоже. С Линкс нужно быть осторожным. Суперполиномы и Хованова-Розанские – две разные вещи для Линкс. Там уже начинаются тонкости, которые очень мало кто знает на самом деле. То, что там суперполином, понятие суперполинома есть Хованова-Розанская. Для Линкс они, в общем, обычно не совпадают. В общем, тут начинается некая каша, и тут, конечно, разговаривать нечего, нужно заниматься через эту функцию. Надо действовать через просто и ясно все определения в одну строчку даются там, или в две строчки. Но это ничего не значит, потому что, конечно, доказать, как мне еще по-другому доказать, что это логически... Да, кстати, для Дахи доказано, это нетривиально, что действительно это логические инварианты, что Даха-конструкция – это логические инварианты. Это доказано, что Даха суперполинома зависит только от топологического типа особенности. Тут есть что делать на самом деле. Например, для торических узлов. Да, нетривиальный факт, что если вы берете RS и TSR, то соответствующий H совпадает. Суперполиномы, Даха и так далее, и так далее. Вот для Дахи, например. Для Дахи это доказано, но это красивое на две странички, на страничке примерно рассуждения, можно меньше. Но, в общем, это нетривиальный факт, что если мы перебрасываем РС, будет та же самая конструкция. Но это сделано, для подхода Дахи это сделано. Вообще говоря, это может быть очень неприятно, такие вещи проверять.
Спасибо, очень интересно.
Спасибо. Невероятная возможность. Сейчас 22. Кто же мне когда даст такую возможность говорить нон-стоп? Спасибо.